Good morning and welcome to our worship service for Sunday, August 30th at East Lynn Christian Church in Anderson, Indiana. I'm Pastor Steve DeFields-Gambrill and I'm honored that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Before we get into our worship hour, I want to share with you just three short announcements of news that you may want to know about. First of all, remember that our Wednesday Bible study happens by Zoom meeting. It's online, but we can talk to each other and interact and see each other. It's been moved to 5 o'clock instead of 4 o'clock. That's so some folks who work during the day can also be there. We had a good crowd last Wednesday, and we hope you'll join us. If you don't know how to use Zoom to do a meeting through your computer or your smartphone, call Debbie Weber or myself, and we'll be glad to get on the phone before Wednesday and talk you through it and teach you how to log into a Zoom meeting. Sometimes it's a little tricky, but we can get you through it. Also want to let you know that, as it turns out, there will be a fish fry on September 11th, Friday, September 11th, from 4 to 7 p.m. We are not doing the fish fry. We're just providing the location. Dan's Fish Fry is the company we usually get the fish from, is going to do it all for us this year, and they'll give us a little bit of money for it, but we're doing it mostly so that Dan's business can stay in operation, because with the pandemic, they are on the in dire financial straits, as you can imagine. And we want them to be able to stay in business. And so if they're going to do it all, then they're going to do it all outside. It's going to be very minimal risk to for the virus, and we won't have any volunteers working together to do the fish fry. So it's nothing you need to do, but if you want to come on September 11th and buy some fish, it'll be drive-through only. Just drive through and buy yourself some fish and a good meal with some vegetables and things to take it home and eat. So Debbie Weber, who's volunteered to help us learn how to use Zoom meetings and operate Zoom meetings, has also volunteered to help people get registered to vote. So if you haven't registered to vote, or if you're not sure about the process for maybe mailing in a ballot instead of going in person to a polling place in November, call Debbie Weber. She knows how to do that, and she'll be glad to bring the paperwork to you. Take it when you finish filling it out, help you fill it out so that you can vote either in person or by mail-in, but you can be registered. Voting is important. And so with those announcements taken care of, let's take a breath and bring ourselves into the presence of God in worship. For our call to worship, as always, we invite you to read the colored and bold printed words in our call to worship. Let us call ourselves to worship together. Feed us now, child of God, as you fed your first disciples. Feed us with that love which overcomes the fears of the world. Feed us with that spiritual bread which strengthens our hands for serving broken and lost people. Feed us, fill us with that joy which the universe cannot contain.
I saw the light, no more dark.
As we come to prayer, I want to mention to you several folks we need to be praying for. George and Monica both had kidney stones crushed on Friday. That's a major deal. They're recovering from that at home. But we're praying that it worked and it worked well, and that those kidney stones will soon be in the past. Also on Friday, Terry went to the doctor to get back on schedule to get his pacemaker put in. We hope that happens quickly so he can start feeling a lot better. Patty is continuing to recover from a fall. It wasn't as bad as the fall she had a year ago, but she's got some bruises and soreness, but she's getting better, and she tells me she's feeling better every day. Jackie also is feeling better these days. She's having a very good week, and we want to continue to pray for Jackie, whose battle is for sure not over, but was having a better week, and we thank God for that. Also, Scott had a doctor's appointment to have his knee looked at. His knee has never been right since his surgery. Was it a year ago now? And so we want to pray for Scott that knee can finally get properly taken care of. I know there are many other prayer requests that are on our hearts and minds. Let's together turn our hearts to prayer. O bread of heaven, come. Come and fill us with your spirit, for your spirit satisfies like no other. We hunger and thirst for you this morning and long to be nurtured in your love and forgiveness. So we come to this sacred time and place, where our hungers are finally and fully satisfied as only your bread can do. We will wait and listen for your leading in this hour. We pray, God, for those whose daily need for healthy food or for clean water and proper shelter goes unmet, and for those misusing what they have in the vain pursuit of pleasure. Feed them with all the good things of Christ for life, now, and in eternity. Have mercy on those whose lives have been broken by violence and crime. Feed them with hope and a new life in Christ. And bless our brothers and sisters in prison and those who minister to them. Heal, Lord, the cancer of racism. Bring passion, compassion, and understanding to us all. Help us to learn how to walk in the shoes of those who are not like us. Calm the rage, the fear, the violence on all sides. Teach us to listen to one another, to talk to one another, without using violence to make our point. Protect us, God, from this pandemic. Speed the work toward a vaccine. Help us all to remember that we are our brothers and our sisters' keepers, that we hold one another's lives in our hands. Help us to protect ourselves and to protect one another. Help us to wear our masks, to keep safe distance, and to wash our hands, for surely other people's lives depend on it. Remind us that what we do can bring life or death to dozens around us. And feed those who are sick or sorrowing with the healing and the consolation of Jesus Christ. We pray particularly for those on our prayer list, those that I named earlier and others. And we pray that you will meet the needs of those we know personally to be in want and those who we now name silently in the hearts of each individual. And finally, we pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
to me shall not hunger, and who believe in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father beckons, and I will my flesh for the life of the world. And if you eat of this bread, you shall live forever. You shall live forever. And I will
Our scripture today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 24 through 35. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Well, now, most of us are convinced that our grandmothers are, or our grandmothers were, saints. But in my case, it just happens to be true. Mama lived on the side of Tremont Mountain in eastern Kentucky. And the thing was that you simply were not allowed to visit Mama's house without eating something. Is your grandmother like that? It doesn't matter that you just ate a five-course meal with a big tub of ice cream for dessert, and if you eat another drop of pop, it doesn't matter. Mama will fuss and fidget and worry, and she won't be able to enjoy the visit until she sees you eat something. But the best meal at Mama's house was breakfast, and that will take some explaining. You see, Mama would frown and growl, but finally, after years of us hassling her, she let us install a new electric range in the kitchen to replace that old wood-burning cook stove where she had to build a fire in the belly of that beast before she could cook anything. But she only let us put in the electric range on the condition that we build a room on the back of the kitchen and keep that old wood-fired cook stove. Now, for the younger crowd, I have to explain that to cook on a wood cook stove, you had to first go outside and get some firewood. Then you had to build a little fire. Then you had to put in bigger pieces of wood and let the fire get hotter in the belly of that stove. That's a lot of work, especially for a woman in her 70s. But she learned to cook on a wood cook stove. That's how she knew how to cook. She never quite, she could figure out how to do other things on the electric stove. But she could never figure out how to make biscuits right in an electric oven. So she always made her biscuits on the wood cook stove, which means she still built that fire and did all that extra work. So that's why at Mama's house, you would wake up on a cold fall mountain morning with fog curling through the valley below. You might wake up in her old feather bed, smothered on a weight of handmade quilts. Feather quilt was one of them. You could smell the fresh coffee. You could smell that old wood burning in the wood stove. And you could smell the bacon frying. And you could smell those biscuits. Those biscuits which came directly from heaven just for you. Hungry yet? Ah, but what are you really hungry for? See, it was only yesterday in our scripture that Jesus had fed the multitude with five barley loaves and a couple of small fish. And they, at that moment, were ready to crown him king, and that was not what he wanted, so he slipped away in the night because he wasn't ready to be crowned king. But they followed him. They followed him all the way across that big lake, and when they found Jesus, Jesus asked them, "Why did you seek me? Was it the free food?" Well, that's not a trivial question. Any church leader knows the best way to draw a crowd is free food. Churches love to eat. But Jesus was asking them, "What are you really hungry for?" We are a world of insatiable hunger. We think we're hungry for stuff, but no matter how many things we buy, we're never really quite satisfied. We've become a hyperactive society. We're hungry for busyness to keep our minds off of a deeper soul hunger, which we're afraid to face. So we fill our lives with things and with busyness and with noise and activity. Everywhere you go, there's a radio or a TV making noise. When people jog or take a walk, instead of listening to the birds and the breeze through the trees, we plug our ears with headphones and zone out into music. Whether you're in a restaurant or a store or an office, there's always music in the background. Makes us wonder, what are we afraid to hear? We allow ourselves a moment of true silence. We are a hungry people, and all of our substitutes do not drown out the sound of our souls growling in hunger. Katie Lang's song is so true from many years ago. She sang that constant craving has always been, and it has. But what are we craving? What are we hungry for? Jesus said, you're looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. He's prodding them to realize what they're hungry for now, now that their bellies are full, because full bellies do not satisfy hungry souls. Not that Jesus is indifferent, by the way, to real hunger, hungry bellies. First, he fed them loaves and fishes that were real and tangible for hungry bellies. Then he offered them the spiritual. That's how my mammal did it. So we begin by feeding the hungry, but that's only where we begin. For even if hunger and poverty and hatred and war were eliminated, we would still crave more. We crave the touch of the sacred. Who among us has not longed for an experience holy? Who among us doesn't long for more magical moments in our lives? We have, and all of us have experienced a few sacred moments. Falling in love is one of those moments. The birth of a child is one of those sacred moments. The spectacular sunset. Once in a while, we even have sacred, powerful moments in church, but not enough. It's not enough to satisfy that deep soul hunger. What are we really hungry for? I'm the bread of life, Jesus told me. And he is. Jesus is the bread of life. This is the central truth of the Christian faith, which we enact every Sunday communion table. What does that really mean? What does that really mean? How do we hear that sentence so that it makes a difference in our lives? There's a theological word, incarnation. The idea that in Jesus Christ, the God of the whole magnificent universe became a human being. Incarnation literally means in a body. That God is found in a flesh and blood body. That God is not out there somewhere. God is here in flesh and blood. Because of the incarnation of Jesus Christ, everything we do with our bodies and in our bodies is sacred, or it can be sacred, or it should be sacred. Ordinary life can be magical, transcendent, because God is in us and God is in our world. When God became flesh in Christ, God made the world of flesh and blood holy. And our world is filled with holiness, waiting to be experienced. It's our habit to say that some things are sacred and some things are not so sacred. They're secular, we say. But in Jesus, there's nothing, or at least there should be nothing in our lives which is not sacred. There should be no secular aspect to life. It's all holy. And that's why the central ritual of the Christian faith is a meal, something real and tangible and fleshly. When we take communion, we surely believe that something sacred and magical happens, and it happens whether we notice it or not, though it helps if we take the bread and wine seriously and remind ourselves of what we're doing, what we believe, pay attention. But either way, it means something, that the central ritual of the Christian faith is as tangible and physical as eating. But incarnation means even more than that. It also means that when we engage in the hard day-to-day work of feeding the hungry, when we volunteer in the soup kitchen or in our food pantry, when we work tirelessly on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday so that hungry people get fed, or when we work, as some of us do, building a home with Habitat for Humanity, or take food to a shut-in or care for children, those moments are just as sacred as Sunday morning. Whenever, wherever, love is made real in flesh and blood, we are in the presence of sacred. More than just her biscuits, you know. We just love to be with Mama. There was about her spirit some sort of healing, some sort of peace, which just came from being with her. You had to know her to understand that. She was just that kind of person. Healing radiated from her presence. Acceptance, love radiated from her presence. I remember my girl cousin saying that they used to love to brush out her coal black hair. She had coal black hair even in her 70s, which hung all the way down to her feet. She was an old mountain woman. Teenage girls, with all the doubts and drama of the teen years, just found peace in the simple act of brushing out her hair. See, at Mama's house, you just knew that you belonged. You belong to her. You came from her. Her blood flows through you. And so at Mama's house, you are loved unconditionally. Doesn't matter how you screwed up or that you feel like a failure. And believe me, our family has had our share of people who screwed up. You're truly included. But she believes in you anyway. And nobody contradicts Mama. She believes that you are the greatest child ever, and Mama is always right. And her faith in you smelled like fresh baked biscuit. I was 19 years old, less than a year out of high school. My girlfriend and I had broken up. I had lost my job. I was lost in the world. I decided I need my Mama. And so I jumped in the car and I drove for the 5 hours down to southeastern Kentucky. Had some car trouble, so I didn't get there till about 2 a.m. And she just had to feed me breakfast at 2 a.m. I just wanted to sleep. But Mama knew that I just had to eat those biscuits. So she fired up that wood stove and that electric stove together and she cooked breakfast. There's no stopping. See, she knew that I had appeared on her doorstep at that hour of the night because I was hurting. She didn't really know what was wrong, except that I was a young man and it's hard to grow up. So she fed me breakfast, pure love in the tangible, physical, incarnate form of biscuits and gravy. I still remember the warmth of that wood stove and the smell of those biscuits and her gnarled hands when she put her hands on my shoulders. I could feel her breath on the back of her neck, of my neck, when she leaned down from behind and whispered, "Love you, Stevie. You're going to be all right. I promise." And when Mama made you a promise, you could count on it. Now, here's the thing. If a grandmother can love a child that much, how much more does our God love us? You know, we tend to be so reserved with God, so afraid of being rejected by God. But coming to Christ ought to be like rolling into Mama's house at 2 a.m. You know, you just know you'll be welcomed and loved and healed no matter what. What we're hungry for is that love. We're starving for love. Like that song by Kathy Mattea, we are standing knee-deep in the river and dying of thirst. We are surrounded by Jesus. We are totally loved by Jesus Christ. We are sitting at the banquet table, offered the bread of life in rich abundance. And yet so many of us are still desperately, spiritually hungry. My brother, my sister, don't you know that you are God's beloved child? You are precious and wonderful to God. Through this bread, through this juice, Jesus Christ is leaning over you right now. Can you feel his breath whispering in your ear? You are my child. I know the burdens you brought with you today. I know you've made mistakes. I know you're hurting. But you're going to be okay. Because I love you, and I that's what Jesus means as I am the bread of life. You know it, and I know it. Love can be baked into a biscuit.
Good news.
right here, no matter what others may say. Your darkest sins will be forgiven, and you will always have a place at the table of grace. The cup's never empty, the plate's always full, and it's never too late to come and be filled with love never ending. You're always welcome at the table. Scar in his eyes, we all are equal.
Yes, we are.
Don't be afraid, come as you are at the table of grace. The cup's never empty, the plate's always full, and it's never too late. Come and be filled with love never ending. You're always welcome at the table of grace.
Love can be baked into a biscuit or into a piece of bread. Love can become real and tangible in our lives. God's grace can take on a physical form. It's there for you. For you, my friend. You're welcome at this table. Let us pray. Holy God, be like a grandmother with open arms. Receive us all. Receive the black sheep of the family. Receive the rebel. Receive the ones of us who are lost and confused, because that really covers us all one way or the other. Sit us down. Wrap your arms around us. Bake for us. Forgive us. Let us know that we are your beloved child and you believe in us. As we take this bread, which represents your body broken, this cup represents you pouring out your life in sacrifice, and seek to come home again. Amen. And as we say it every week, we remember how Jesus took the bread, in this case a biscuit, and broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat." And he took the cup, poured it, and said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and eat."
One body, one Lord of all.
one body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and
Savior, if you don't have those kind of warm, welcoming arms to come home to when it's late at night, life is difficult, I want to invite you to accept Jesus into your life right now, because he has already accepted you into his life. His arms are open wide. His front door is unlocked. Come home to Jesus right now, and you will be restored. I also want to remind our church members and any others who would like to that our church's ministries go on even though our building is not open right now. We spend a lot of time and energy feeding the hungry in our food pantry. Our phone still rings. The bills still need to be paid. We hope you will remember our church in your tithes and offerings, and keep remembering us until we're able to meet face to face once again. You may mail in your check. The address is on your screen. If you're local in Anderson, you can drive by and just put it in the mailbox. The mailbox is locked. No one can take it back out of there except our treasurer and our church secretary. So you can drop it off. You can mail it in. Please do remember us in your prayers and in your tithes and offerings as you are able. May our God, in whose presence alone is fullness of joy, be so real to us that we can be confident, however dark the night, that joy will come in the morning.